Hi, so in this chapter, we're going to go through all of the animals except the chordates. And we call these animals invertebrates because they don't have a backbone. And it actually seems like kind of a silly name for them because we only are focused on the vertebrates because we're a vertebrate. But the invertebrates are more than 95% of the known species of animals, and many of them are unknown. There are probably hardly any unnamed vertebrates, but there are thousands and possibly millions of species of unnamed invertebrates. So we don't even know all of these that exist. And as we're going through here, there's a lot of different classifications of organisms. So what I'd like you to focus on is how they all fit together. So not the details of each little group, but what it tells us about the diversity of each phylum. And that's really the main category in animals to focus on is the phyla. So what phyla does something belong to? Or what phylum, if I'm using the singular, what phylum does something belong to, and then the class and the order after that that tells us something about it. So, for example, this sea dragon here is in the phylum Mollusca, so it's in the same phylum as snails and octopus, and it's a gastropod, which means that it's a slug of some kind. And it's in the subgroup here, nudibranchs. So think about these categories as we go through them. What are the main characteristics of them? And how do they all fit together? Because animals had an origin, just like all life on Earth had an origin. Animals as a kingdom had an origin. And how did it branch during the course of evolution? And what were those new traits that evolved at each level? So here's a kind of a basic overview of the animal kingdom, and we're going to go through most of this in this chapter. We'll talk about the most basal animals, which are the sponges, and that phylum is Porifera. Another basal group are the Cnidaria, which includes jellyfish and Hydra, and these are Cnidaria are radially symmetric, Porifera don't have any symmetry. And then there are the bilaterally symmetric animals. And these are divided into three main groups, and these are not phyla. These are groups that contain several different phyla within them. So, and we started talking about these in the last chapter. These, especially these two here, the Lophotrochozoa and the Ecdysozoa, were determined using DNA because, as you'll see, there's a lot of overlap in traits between organisms in these two groups. It's like, well, should we use, you know, having a chitinous exoskeleton as one of them? Well, there's, you know, some in here that have that too. What about a ciliated feeding structure? Well, some in here have that, and actually, there's one over here that does too. So DNA really helped sort these groups out and make sense out of them. And then lastly, we'll talk about the deuterostomes, which includes our phylum, the chordates. And then the next chapter is all about the chordates. So there are right now about 36 phyla within the animal kingdom. And this is the latest consensus animal phylogeny that I could find. This one was from a few years ago, maybe 4 years ago this one was published. And it includes all the known phyla. And some of them have changed, changed names. Some have been combined into a single phylum, like the rotifers here were combined with another phylum. Some phyla were split into multiple phyla based on DNA. And there are 9 phyla that contain the most species. They contain most species that are alive today, and so we call those the Big 9. Your book chapter does not call them the Big 9, but that's kind of, maybe they think that's old fashioned, but I think it's useful to, because it gives you, because otherwise we just have all of these phyla. Which one should we focus on? So focus on the big nine. They have the most species. They're the most important for human health, for agriculture. So these are the ones that we're going to focus on the most. And we'll talk about the other ones, many of the other ones, just because they're interesting sometimes from an evolutionary point of view. Sometimes they're interesting just because they're weird. But one of the things that we do know about animals, oh, and you'll notice in here in this tree, there are some dotted lines. So these are unsure relationships. For example, the A seals, the Xenocoelomorpha, it's unclear whether they're a sister group here to the echinoderms, or are they actually a more basal group, and possibly they're the most basal group in all of the bilateral animals. And another dotted line over here is like, exactly where do the ctenophores and the cnidaria fit? How are they related? So the dotted lines here indicate uncertainty. So the arguments aren't over yet over how to categorize these organisms. And remember, the phylogeny is supposed to represent what happened during evolution. So when we have something like this, where we have all of these different phyla splitting off from a single point, because see, this is one big line here, that is a big point of uncertainty. That means we just don't know what happened, because there couldn't have been a seven-way split from one single ancestor. So here you see there's another uncertainty here. So we're going to focus on the big nine, and we'll talk about a few of the other ones, but we are not going to get all 36. We do know that animals first evolved in the sea. Animals first appeared during the Ediacaran period and had a real explosion in diversity during the Cambrian, and all of that was in a marine environment in the sea. So all animal phyla originated in the sea. There are some animal phyla today that have no members left, no species left in the sea. But all phyla originated as marine species and then later adapted to land. Most phyla still have, if they have members on land, they also still have members in the sea. But we'll talk about that. So it's a little different than plants, where they're pretty much all terrestrial. For animals, plants evolved on land, and they're pretty much all on land today. For animals, animals evolved in the sea, and all the phyla that are around today originated in the sea. Almost all of them still have, or exclusively have, their species in the marine environment. So here's some of the basal metazoans. So metazoan is the scientific word for animal. And these, by basal, we mean these are the most primitive. These probably were the first to evolve. Some of these we have fossil evidence for during the Ediacaran, like jellyfish and sponges. We have fossil evidence of them. The others we don't for sure have fossil evidence that early. But these five phyla are considered to be the most basal. So we'll talk about these each one at a time. So basal, again, meaning the earliest to diverge, and the oldest phyla in the animal kingdom. So Porifera are considered to be the oldest animal phyla. The first animal was some sort of a sponge. And again, I'm going to put up here every time one of the phyla that I'm talking about is in the big nine, I'll put that up in the corner. So sponges are the first one that's in the big nine, Porifera. And this is from, I'm not sure if it's a Latin or Greek root, but it means it's full of holes, pores. It has pores. It's full of holes. Sponges don't move as adults, but they do have a larval stage that swims, as all animals do. All animals have a motile stage that moves and swims, or possibly they always move. But if they have a sessile adult stage, then they have a motile larval stage. Sponges only live in the water, mostly marine, although there are a few freshwater sponges. I have a video here of a sponge so that you can see what it's actually doing, because they don't look very active, but if you put a non-toxic dye near them, you can see how much water they're actually pumping. And that's what this little video is of here.
Sponges are very effective filter feeders since they're able to capture and eat particles as small as bacteria, as well as larger particles. They might not look like they're doing much, but a simple demonstration shows how effectively sponges can pump water. On a reef in the Caribbean, I make a dive with a syringe filled with a non-toxic dye called fluorescein. By squirting it around the base of some sponges, we can observe how the water is moving by watching what the dye does. Within only seconds, the dye is pumped through the sponges along with the water. As you can see, a sponge is a pretty good water pump and also a good strainer. Any plankton that goes in with the water won't come back out through the osculum. Tube sponges are even more spectacular to observe. They pump the dye so furiously that they look like a collection of miniature smokestacks.
So they look like they're just sitting there, but they're actually pretty active. So, and it's the action of the choanocytes that is causing all of that water flow. So they are the first animals evolved from the protists, the choanoflagellates, which look pretty much just like this. They have a single flagella that whips around and draws water in. And the way that they move in sponges draws water in through the holes at the sides and shoots it out of the top. And they are filter feeders. So all the little choanocytes are filtering food and passing it on to the other cells in the sponge. So sponges don't really have tissues. They do have specialized cells, including specialized reproductive cells, which is why they're considered true animals and not a colonial organism. So the two cell types that feed, the choanocytes, and here's a nice scanning electron microscope image of what those look like with their little basket of microvilli and the longer flagella that moves the water. So they're complete filter feeders. And then the amoebocytes, which are named because under the microscope they look sort of amoeba-shaped. They help pass on the food and manufacture the spicules inside of the sponge. Sponges have motile larvae, which all animals do. If their adult stage is not motile, then the larval stage is. Most sponges are hermaphroditic, meaning that each individual sponge has cells that are going to produce eggs and other cells that are going to produce sperm. They release the eggs and sperm into the water column simultaneously with other nearby sponges of the same species. A small larvae is formed. It swims around and feeds for a while because, of course, these flagellated cells are the choanocytes that are able to feed. So it swims around for a while and feeds and then settles down somewhere and turns into a sponge. Placozoans are really weird. They're barely recognizable as an animal. Only a single species was known for over 100 years, and it was debated whether it was even an animal at all. The name means flat, placozoa, flat animal. They don't have tissues either. They just kind of have an outside layer that's covered with cilia, and they move along the seafloor. They don't swim. They kind of crawl along the seafloor. They're really, really tiny. They're only about a millimeter across, so very, very tiny. It's amazing that they were discovered at all. But as you can see, they have barely, you know, any differentiation, just an outer layer with cilia and then an inner layer, and they get all of their food and everything by diffusion and by the individual cells on the outside take in little food particles by phagocytosis and pass that on to the inner cells that aren't being directly exposed to the seawater. So DNA analysis, because they don't really have any morphology, so how do we know where to put them? Well, DNA analysis places them as a basal organism after the sponges, so they are not the most basal animals. Sponges are older, that's what that means, and the placozoans appeared at some point later, but they are within the animal clade. So all of the DNA studies that we've done shows that animals are a monophyletic clade. Animals didn't appear multiple times from a protist ancestor. That's what that means. So even though placozoans look weird, they don't look like anything else. We only know a few species now. They are definitely within the metazoans, and they are basal, but not as basal as sponges are. So very odd. Another basal group is the ctenophores, and these are the comb jellies. In fact, that's what their name means. Teno here is Greek for comb. And that's because of these long rows here of cilia, these combs of cilia, generally 8 combs of cilia, that they use to kind of slowly move through the water. And these are also a very basal lineage after sponges. And about the same, they split off from the rest of animals about the same time as the cnidarians, which is a much larger group. Ctenophores, only about 100 species are known. Of course, they live in many of them live in the deep ocean, so probably there are quite a few undiscovered species, but they're very beautiful to watch them swim. Cnidarians. Okay, here's a basal group that's in the big 9 besides Porifera. So the cnidaria have about 10,000 species. Most of those are jellyfish. There also include corals and also hydras and then a few weird things. Cnidaria are diploblastic, which if you remember from the last chapter, that means they have 2 germ layers. So when the embryo goes through gastrulation and you have the ectoderm and the endoderm layers, so start out with a blastula that's a single layer, and then part of that pouches in to give you 2 germ layers, then that's all that they have, mostly. There's a few cnidarians that seem to have a middle mesoderm layer, and their muscle-like cells that help contract the bell in some groups seem like they're mesodermal, but you know, it's like anything else in biology. You make a general rule, and as well, there's these other things over here that don't comply to that rule. There are sessile ones and motile ones. And of course, the sessile ones, that means that they have a motile larvae. They have a nerve net, but no brain. And the net reacts to stimulus and helps them to have rhythmic swimming motions for the jellies. They're carnivores. They eat fish. They eat other small animals. So the carnivore means they eat other animals. They're not eating seaweed or things like that. They're eating animals. And they sting their prey to paralyze them before they eat them, which makes sense because they have very soft bodies and they're fragile. So being able to paralyze your active prey seems like a good idea. So they have specialized cells in their tentacles called cnidocytes. And then within those cells are stinging structures that eject a stinging thread. And those are called nematocysts. So the nematocyst is part of the cnidocyte. And I have a little video here of an anemone feeding. And this one is just an amateur video that somebody from Australia posted of their fish tank. So you hear people talking that aren't scientists, but you'll see.
Oh my God. No way.
Oh my God.
That's where the blue fish went. That's crazy.
How did it get in there? It just went on its own.
No, that shrimp put it there.
You're kidding.
I'm not joking, you pulled it.
That's gone, Peter. That's gonna eat it.
Oh my God. It was trying to swim away and the shrimp grabbed it by the tail, pulled it back, and put it in there.
So cnidarians have a one-way gut, and that means that, or I should say a one-opening gut. So that means they have no anus. Their mouth and their anus are the same opening. So food goes in, and anything that doesn't get digested comes back out the same opening. So here's their stinging cells. So the cnidocyte is the whole cell. And then the nematocyst is the part of the cell that has this little thread that can evert and inject the fish with a little bit of toxin that will paralyze it, so that that prevents damage to the jellyfish or the anemone because they're quite fragile. So the cnidarians are divided into two big clades. One that contains all of the sea anemones and corals, the things that only have the sessile forms, and then the ones that swim around, the active ones. And these are the medusozoans. This bell shape that we associate with jellyfish, that's called the medusa form. And then this the form like a sea anemone or a coral has, that's called the polyp stage. So anthozoans and antho here, that's a familiar root, isn't it, from anthophyta in the plants, the flowering plants. So antho means flower. So anthozoans, zoa is animal. So anthozoans are the flower animals because they're sessile and they look sort of like flowers. So the medusozoans, this clade contains all the cnidarians that at some stage in their life cycle produce a medusa. So the medusa is what we commonly think of when we think of a jellyfish. This is a medusa form here. It's a bell shape. The mouth is underneath, and so are the stinging tentacles. And there are three big groups of medusozoans. Not all of them produce a medusa, but all the ones that do produce a medusa are in this group. Cyphozoa, this is the group that contains all of the things that we think of as jellyfish. Cubozoans are the box jellies, and they're called box jellies because they tend to have groups of four tentacles, and they have many of them have kind of a weird squarish look. Box jellies. And then the hydrozoans, which is more of a mixed bag. There's a lot more variety in the hydrozoans. There's ones that alternate between a medusa and a polyp. Some of them only have a polyp. Some of them are colonial, like the Portuguese man of war is a hydrozoan. It's a colony of medusa and polyps, thousands of tiny ones. It's really a weird one. And it used to be thought because of this, because the hydrozoans alternated between a medusa and a polyp stage for most of them, that this was the basal group within the cnidarians, and that the ancestral cnidarian was one that alternated between a medusa and a polyp. And that DNA showed that was wrong. Once again, like so many things, once we looked at the DNA evidence, it's like, well, that whole hypothesis, we'll throw that out. So it turns out that, in fact, the anthozoans are the basal group within the cnidaria. So hydrozoans are weird. And some of them have a medusa and a polyp stage, and some of them just have a polyp stage. So freshwater hydra, for example, are just a polyp. And there's one that's a colony. So they're odd, but they tend to be more active. The cyphozoans are the ones we most picture when we think jellyfish. So for the medusozoans, many of them have a polyp stage and a medusa stage. So the medusa stage is an active swimmer. The polyp sticks to a substrate, and they both have tentacles. They both have a single mouth opening, and they are feeders in the water column of small and large prey. They're both carnivorous, but the difference is movement. And so it turns out this is not the ancestral condition for cnidarians. The medusa evolved later, that the ancestral condition is actually the polyp. So for the medusozoans, they alternate between these two forms. Generally, the medusa is the sexually active form, and the polyp can reproduce vegetatively by budding. And often both types, the polyp and the medusa stage of the life cycle, reproduce. And sometimes these get confused with the plant genophyte sporophyte alternation of generations, but these are all diploid. There's no gametophyte here. Just like all animals, their only haploid stage in the life cycle are the eggs and sperm. Everything else is diploid. So in one of these that alternates, in the medusozoans, we have our fertilization here. Fertilization and our little larva forms, which swims around for a while, develops into a polyp. Now, there are medusozoans that skip the polyp stage, and the little larvae turns right into a little tiny medusa. But for many of them, they develop into a filter feeding polyp. The polyps eventually start to shed medusa. So the top of the polyp will break off and form a little medusa and start to swim around. And then it will make another one and another one and another one. That's asexual reproduction. So one single larva could produce many medusa. The anthozoans, the flower animals, they are, it turns out, the basal cnidarians. So the ancestral cnidarian, the first cnidarian, was an anthozoan. And then the medusa lifestyle developed later. Some have a bit of an exoskeleton. The corals form a hard exoskeleton, and also have, many of them have symbiotic algae that live in their bodies. This is a fairly recent evolutionary occurrence, though, so they can expel the algae. The algae survive this, the coral survives this, and then if they recover from their stress, whatever it was, they can retake up the algae into their cells. So anthozoans are only polyps. There's no medusas in the anthozoans. Our last basal group in the animals is the Acoela. So this means without a coelom. That's where the name comes from. This prefix means doesn't have it. So Acoela means no coelom. And previously, these Acoela flatworms were grouped with the platyhelminths, the other flatworms, because they seem a lot like them. But DNA, again, showed that, in fact, they're very distantly related. And, in fact, they belong in their own phylum, which is also sometimes named Xenocoelomorpha. For Xena here meaning strange. So strange Acoela mates is what the name means. And they're kind of flatworm-like. But they're basal. They have a simple one-way or one opening gut, like flatworms and like cnidarians, have a single opening gut, so no anus, only a mouth. So in that way, they're very similar. And species like this, like the Acoela, are really of great interest because of where they are placed in the phylogeny. Animals like they're the basal bilaterians. So all of those previous ones that I mentioned are radially symmetric, or like the Porifera, I have no symmetry at all. So the Acoels are bilaterally symmetric, and they have directionality to their movement. And they're extremely basal. Molecular evidence, that means DNA sequencing, shows that they're extremely basal within the bilaterian. So the most ancestral animals that had a head and a tail were probably like these. Okay, in the next one, we will talk about the Lophotrochozoa, which that horrible name was made by taking two groups that were previously separate, the lophophores, and ones that had a trochophore larvae, and DNA showed they actually belonged in the same phylum. So we put the two words together and made a horribly long name that almost nobody can pronounce. Okay, that'll be the next one.